Let's get cracking.
Welcome back, everybody, here to our final game of the D2CL. For tonight, it is MYM going up against Evil Geniuses in a game which has now become a dead rubber. There was one chance that MYM could be able to get themselves into the D2CL playoffs, which is to begin within the next fortnight, and that is if they went 2-0 over EG. I know the task is not a simple one that was asked of them, and unfortunately have fallen short. So they are one game down now against Evil Genius. They got really, well, nailed badly by this Tinker Visage kind of combination. All the other heroes caused problems to, especially that Batrider initiation, which this time was banned out. But still, those familiar birds with the Tinker on the back of them was just so damn scary that I'm not surprised MYM GG'd out before even some of their tier 2 towers were down. So game number 2 does begin, and EG kick off with a Darkseer Dream Protector. So welcome to teamfight combination time. While Meet Your Makers, they're going for a DK as well as a Wisp. So it's survivability during the fight, especially for the DK when the Wisp is able to heal him up during the engagement. It's also potential for relocate and a different kind of lane. Now, they're banning at the Luna, and they ban out the Dazzle. This, to me, just says that EG don't care about a tiny Wisp combination, which is a huge flag already for me. The fact that, one, they don't care, and two, they're happy, like, they play up against it when they now get, like, okay, Lich, Dream Protector, Radiant and Darkseer. Man, this combination is so, again, scary if it works. And we always talk about the fact, like, the major problem with the Wisp Relocate is he brings a hero in right next to him. So it takes time to get away. Normally, you can get at least 3 bounces off a Lich ultimate before you're able to split far enough that the Wisp Tether, the Wisp Tether has to break. So you even remove the extra buff up when the two heroes arrive in the lane. Another major problem. 5 seconds. Another major problem. So, Meet Your Makers now. The third pickup to come their way, crit. Reserve time. With the DK as well as the Wisp. Who else will they try and combo with this? They may as well just get either their secondary support. They know they're starting to run up against a lineup, which is actually very, very defensive. If I was MYM in this game, I'd try and force a push somewhere. Okay, Rubick Control is not bad. It's not bad. It's not what I was searching for, though. I thought maybe they could try something with, like, Lashrak, try and force pushes in different lanes, and just get on top of both MYM as well as EG. Get on top of EG. Now, EG, they play a little bit more of a later focus of the game. So, Mason will get a Morphling. Possibly Arteezy in the middle lane could also take that. But more than likely, it'd be Mason up on that top lane to take the Morphling, which means Lich could babysit him or the middle lane. They could run a dual lane in the mid, for example. If this will be a DK in mid, you could just run a melee there instead. A nice, big, tanky kind of melee hero that can work nicely with a Lich, who would then zone out the DK as well as, like, start to steal all the levels from him, or the experience gain at least.
5 seconds remaining.
And then crit, well, I just feel like they need to force something. If they play defensive against this, yes! Meet Your Makers pull out their signature hero. A hero that in the early stages with a nice early Shadow Blade can really inflict some heavy casualties on the enemy. And that's what they're going to attempt to do right now. Nyx Assassin will be the final ban out. Looking to avoid every single one of those, like, invis worrisome heroes. And with EG's lineup, the obvious last pickup for them is the SF. When you have tree ulti, Darkseer back into a Lich ulti, remaining. You want to have SF in the middle of that winding up for his. That's why I'm kind of feeling that it's Mason as the Morphling, as opposed to having, like, Arteezy as that Morphling. And that's going to take out the Weaver, so they're still looking towards Mason. Those last two bans are directed towards him. Both the Mirana as well as the Weaver are both Mason's heroes. He plays them beautifully. So EG may have to go down a different line right now. They could go, no, you wouldn't want to do that. I was thinking Faceless Void, but the combo synergy doesn't work properly with both Darkseer as well as Treant. Works nicely with Lich, but even then, with Morphling, he would just shotgun from outside the bubble.
10 seconds.
But they need something like an SK, which could just epicenter in and throw himself into the middle of the, into the chrono.
Reserve time.
But PPD's definitely taking his time with this last pickup. Maybe that Weaver was what he was searching for. The other toss-up could just be the conversation between the players. Who plays the Morphling? Which lane do we want him to go? In the middle lane with the Wisp as well as DK, Morphling won't be able to get himself a kill unless they're running both Morphling and Lich in the mid. And then you'll have both Waveform for repositioning to basic attacks, and then Lich with a Frost Blast early on. That's the way you could be able to pick off that Wisp in the early stages of the game, and they get the Bloodseeker.
Radiant team pick.
I was getting some inside info from EG before the at the end of last game, saying normally they actually like to play, well, the combination they had in the last game, the Tinker and the Visage together, they enjoy playing that with the Bloodseeker because it's just, you can't win against it. But with the Bloodseeker now coming up, it creates a new problem for Slark. Because Slark, when he drops low enough, is now going to become visible. Which means he will not, I believe this is the way the mechanics work, because he is visible with the Bloodthirst from Bloodseeker, he will not be able to regenerate because he's visible to the enemy, which means he loses his high movement speed. So a low life Slark can no longer just move in and out and evade the enemy. It will be RTZ on that Morphling, but Bloodseeker can also be switched towards that mid lane just like they did previously. So, into the game we head. Universe, as always, to play the offlane of Darkseer. We expect nothing less. PPD's Train Protector, and then Zai will take up the Lich, and all the others we have already covered. So, Ryze, he'll be the DK. So, solo mid DK will be there. We'll have Crit as the Rubik, the grandest of the Megases. He'll be heading down to the bottom lane right now, and Ace is going to also be heading down to that bottom lane as Nature's Prophet. Boots first, and they're going to attempt to run Link in the offlane as the Slark with the Wisp behind him. This is the goal right now of MYM, and they're going to be battling up against the Bloodseeker. Now, this is actually quite a decent lane at the very start for Slark. He'll be stealing off a lot of that essence out of the Bloodseeker, and Bloodseeker's going to have himself a bit more of a rough time up on this top, so I expect the Lich to leave RTZ in the very early stages of this laning phase. Because Crit's going to be a bit of a nuisance, but not that much of one. And RTZ to have early levels is probably more important. In fact, I think we may already be having Lich head north. Like, Zai's out a little bit further right now, but the chances is he'll probably just take a creep and then head himself up this direction. That's the chances. Universe will be chilling back. So body blocking up from the very, very start. A little tree is going to scout the fact that PPD is also coming down this bottom lane. So an invis rune to start with, and Crit just denies it. Doesn't want the advantage there for PPD, and doesn't want to risk coming out too far to pick it up anyway. It looks like Zai's going to stick with the mid. They screwed up the block a little though. One of the creeps got away. Ryze lost one of his, but the creep's already going to move up towards the high ground, which means now Ryze actually has the advantage until Zai comes in, and they're already actually 31 experience points in front. It's amazing what Sacrifice can do when you take a creep this early on. But Ryze is still going to be very careful here. Breathe Fire or not, I know he's trying to rush up into the bottle, but they're just going to try and beat down his life points to bring him to a point, especially that this can happen. There's a lot of DPS that kicks out from Morphling with a Wraith Ban, as well as that early points of agility. You see he's only got 5 points, 5 plus 8 left in strength. 397 life points. That's why the Breathe Fire was also so effective. But it has collateral. With no stun, it means Morphling feels very confident just to have a crack at anything. You notice at the bottom lane too, this is EG trying to wait for the secondary Iron Shell. And then they dive in with Leech Seed to slow down Ace. That, I think, is the objective right now. Because with the second Iron Shell, he'll burn through these little treants. Which I find actually kind of quite amusing. These things are called treants, and they're going up against the Treant Protector. He's obviously not protecting them. There is a fault in the lore here when these two go up against each other. Almost where Nature's Prophet should actually be called Tree and Protector. And then, well, then again, Nature's Prophet does send these trees into battle all the time, so he doesn't really protect them that well. Ah, oh, Ryze. He's at least able to run this bottle now, so he feels a lot more confident on the lane. The 2-minute rune's about to spawn up, but at the same time, PBD's already moving in, and if Ryze heads down south to pick up this rune, he's dead. In fact, he's dead already. The tree's coming in, he's going to go for the Leech Seed, and one more attack, bottle charges, PPD can't reach him! Living armor, he has to. Tower.
is under attack.
He's just going to back up, mate. Give it over towards Arteezy instead. Ryze counters his lucky, lucky stars right there. Universe may not be as lucky. He's got Surge available, he's now going to use it, but Crit's going to pick him up and drag him back, and this Surge is now going to wear off. Living armor to try and keep him alive. He's already munching his tango, so his regeneration's quite good. But Universe, he's got blocked up by a tree line. So because of that, around the sides, Universe surges off cooldown. A quick salve, Crit will attack. He moves into the tree line, tries to cut out the other side, and he's away. Frost Blast to come out here from Zai, and they can turn in for the Iron Chill. At the same time, First Blood's over on the Darkseer, but Ace is still going to go down here on the bottom lane, and they're going to turn into more. While Bloodseeker may have gone down first, this is going to be the better fight to watch, because it's going to be a Frost Blast into Crit. Zai with that DD damage, he does so much. And EG will pick up two kills inside the Radiant jungle. While Bloodseeker died up on that top lane. Not enough protection. Link still searching for an opening on PPD. Living Armor's going to protect him for now. Tether in. PPD really slowed up. Telekinesis as well. Rubik's joined the fight. And now they get the lease over on Bloodseeker. And he can't outrun this. No boots. And Link's got his with a poor man's shield. They lose both heroes up on the top lane. And Bloodseeker dies twice within the same amount of minutes. So MYM having some really good work happening in with that Slark. Now up with full strength treads. They couldn't have asked anything better for the hero who was meant to be the early game pressure. The one I was looking for as well for MYM to try and be the ones to set the tone. That's exactly what has happened here. We got bottles coming down to the bottom lane for Monsieur Spacer. Except that's not coming to the bottom lane. He's Spacer. Yeah, it is. It's Universe. I hate the fact those things don't match up. If you don't know what I'm talking about, when you look at the couriers, I need a courier with items on it. There we go. So, courier with items on it. When you look to it, it says TJO, which is actually blue, which is actually Crit. The names they have inside the lobby is still assigned. It's not their official nicknames, it's what appears above their heads and in all other areas, but the ownership of the items, which is coded into the courier, is actually showing up as incorrect. Bottom lane, they're going to have another crack. Creep Wave's already there. Universe preps a second Iron Shell. And now, Leech Seed. Tree's going to try and block him out. Is there a VAC level? Is there something that have enough damage here? They have to burn through these trees so PBD can get free. But Link, perfect timing to come in. PBD cannot TP out in time. Universe has a Surge. He's going to use it. The Sprout's going to be available from Prophet right now. Cuts Universe in, or holds Universe in, as he can't cut back out again. But then again, Link could attack it, but now he can. The leash is on again, and Universe has nowhere to go. Living Armor to try and protect him. A secondary Surge, but cannot move fast enough away. With both Dark Pact as well as Attack from Nature's Prophet kicking in. And Prophet's now going to crack level 6 as well. So now we're adding Wrath of Nature to all future engagements. I think I have another crack at mid. Not underneath the tower when they don't have a creep wave. Arteezy does a point blank range waveform to get two last hits. Follow that greed to the ends of the earth. DK really has, though, been crippled in this mid. 11 for 2 up against a 30 for 11. Darkseer for his death, singular, has still managed to grab 33 CS off this bottom lane. So advantage wise, even though there's kills going the way of MYM and the gold and experience are coming their way, it really should be a lot more for the ganks they've been able to achieve. That's just because in the CS in the lanes, while the ganks aren't going on, they're getting themselves further in front. Of course, there is the other side of the crippling, and that's over on Mason. This Bloodseeker's only got 12 last hits on him, and 2 deaths to his name, so there's just no gold for him available. And this Whisper's almost hit level 6 too. So we're going to have that Slark involved in almost every single semi-possible engagement. They just relocate in, and then it's more than possible. Zai body blocking up Mishio biceps. Arteezy not looking too healthy there in the middle lane, also having to back up.
Radiant's bottom.
Did he leave
tower
a replica behind
attack
or something? Doesn't look like it. Well, he just moved back so we can get the bottle charges. That could be the other reason. Top lane, Link. He's in very, very deep right now. There is currently the silence over on him, and that's from the Bloodseeker. It's a bit of a catch 22 because they silence up Link. But he isn't able to then leash, but he does a lot of damage when he's able to right-click in. He's already dishing out 90 plus 3. Now a little bit lower because he lost those 2 essence points. But when Bloodseeker buffs him up, damage increase of 30%. Yeah, Link will take that. He'll have the Wisp also there on his tail, just to help him out. And now they might give this a shot. Frost Blast on Link. It's negligible damage being dealt. But Link definitely wants to try and find someone. He's looking for the hero which just ran away. That was the Lich, just a little bit too late in that rotation around the side. That was Ace, 31 for 8 in this bottom lane. It's not the easiest time in the world, but he's done a really good job of getting those last hits in. Well, crit on his way to level 6. How's our support levels actually looking? 4-4, and then a 6-5. But the Bloodseeker still not hitting his Rupture yet. Wisp relocate. We're coming down. Easy solo kill on Zai. When I say solo kill, it's just one hero being there. And they take the Invis rune, the Illusion rune as well. And then time to head back. I go back up north, so Illusion rune in hand. Kill as well. A fresh drum's being purchased up here by Link. And now they're trying to force the tier 1 tower. Living armor can't protect it when you got that Illusion rune from the Wisp. Just rip straight through it. But the creep wave will still do the job, because this lineup cannot push towers until D-Tay as well as Nature's Prophet basically form up together. That's the only way they're really going to get it. And how much damage has Ryze done? Just under 200 to that top tower, to that mid tower. Which PPD is already on the way of healing up. So the continuous harassment Dyer's on that doesn't work, but doing this, this does. Now, Leech Seed to start with, so PPD's got some more time, and they cancel both the TPs. They say there's no reason to really go in for it. Ryze getting a little bit of harassment from Arteezy. The waveform did miss, though, so Arteezy does not have the advantage in this engagement. And they're also losing out. So there goes the top tier 1, with another 20 seconds left before a relocate's available. And they're just using it for mana regeneration between the two of them at the moment. But he'll take Link with him. And they'll probably look down towards that bottom lane where Crit is desperately trying to defend up against Universe. So full treads now finished up for the Morphling. There's Ring of Aquila as well as Magic Wand. It's going to be only a matter of time before Arteezy decides to move out and try and go for a kill. Noticing too this Wisp as well as Slark. All they're doing is waiting for a target. They want nothing less, nothing more. The pouncing has to happen instantly as well. But PPD's just around the corner. So if Link pounces into this, he's got to have Dark Pact on almost instantly. Getting that silence off from Bloodseeker. He's also going to wait until that Dark Pact's been used. Or else Link just breaks free of it. Now, mid tier 1 tower being attacked, and this one I'm talking about. With Prophet and DK combining their forces, then MYM have a way of forcing out buildings. Forcing also rotation to come in from EG. That's exactly what's happening. He uses that's a couple of his treants to keep the creep wave away. Prophet Ollie would bounce through PBD, but no one's there. It's actually, sorry, down the bottom lane where I should be looking. Relocate came in, and they're going in Arteezy. Living armor. He doesn't have mana to actually, oh wait, that wasn't the intent. They actually let him go. Lich will die in the middle lane, and a little bit further down, Rubick will also take a fall. I think initially they wanted to leave the Slark down there, but the tether was still up. So Link finds himself on top, he's silenced, they need to do some kind of DPS, and there it is. Treant punches the Slark. And brings him down, so two heroes lost for a little bit of a tether back to the top lane, which I don't think Wisp really intended. To drag the Slark with him, denying the extra kills in that bottom lane against the EG cores. And also leaving Rubick in the lurch. He was down there by himself and he couldn't do anything about it. Because with the Slark gone as well as the Wisp gone, there was no reason for them to fall back. They could just finish off that one hero they found, focus him down, and then fall themselves back. And that's really problematic because that's bought some space for Evil Geniuses. The advantage is really kicking up for MYM until that point. And now EG can free farm top. We're coming up in the courier. Ogre Club, we've got Boots. Bloodseeker's finally finding himself some farm with a fresh hand of Midas. There's Universe. Okay, he's it's the level of farm they're really looking to acquire. With Tether in, and they're gonna try and make Universe pay for this. Iron Shell was stolen. Living Arm is protecting Universe. He surges away. The Telekinesis is gonna go over right now on Zai. They gotta stay close, and then Lich Aldi bounces up. Does actually go down though. But it's still a 1-for-1 trade on the supports of all things here. And Ryze was considering moving down, but rightly so, didn't do it. There's already too many heroes on this bottom lane. They had four heroes during that engagement where all they got was a one-for-one trade. While you've still got Mason farming up on this top lane, getting his Bloodseeker a little bit bigger. Where that Wisp Relocate go? Okay. Went to middle lane. Morphling's already back at base though, so... And no one else is in middle lane, so the Relocate going down for... No advantage at all. And now they're back on the bottom lane waiting for a kill to come, but... At the same time now, RTZ TP's himself in towards the mid. Trying to bait out a bit of a battle here from Ryze with a Frost Blast, but... At the same time, he's also just here for the CS. Same can be said about that Bloodseeker. They're trying to run and stack. Oh, they found one. Ryze, back down again. Frost Blast, Universe, doing a nice little body block. But PvD just says, may as well cast the ult to ensure this kill. Waveform from Morphling will get it too. And Link can't reach him in time. So DK goes down. And they go back to their objective MYM, which is the bottom tier 1 tower, which is really proving to be rather meddlesome. While in middle lane, RTZ wants to beat down this tier 1 tower. So it's not a happy day for most towers. Universe, not to surge if he wants to get himself in range for a vac wall. It was too late for the initiation, as MYM had already backed up. Speaking of Universe, that will be a mech recipe inside of his inventory. Which means right now... Okay. There's almost, like, yeah, the makeup for the Darkseer. Slark's still trying to work in towards that BKB of his after picking up the drum, so he's quite a fat Slark for 14 minutes into the game. But I'm seeing A's trying to build into a Necro Book. Later on, that's going to have little to no effect, apart from, like, early effect is going to be the better thing, killing off the Morphling, take away his mana, take away his escape mechanisms. But then there's Arcane Boots up for the Rubik, but that's the only pair. Yeah, they can keep forcing it after that point. But there's two Arcane Boots with PPD as well as Universe. So they've got some help right now. A little bit of trouble coming in for Nature's Prophet. Wisp relocates on the way in here. Bloodseeker with the Leech Seed. They're going to kill off. Dire's Courier has been sniped off in the middle of this, but then a waveform in coming in from RTZ. They try to pick up and throw back Universe. Successful to get the double stun, the Telekinesis, but Link, he's currently silenced up. He wants to pounce himself away. The Darkseer wall goes down and he pounces into the river. 31 life points. Morphling waveforms down. Adaptive Strike level 2 will take the kill. Lich was a sacrificial lamb in this engagement, but RTZ, he's sticking up with Ryze. With that haste rune, why wouldn't you? PPD surged up, can't get himself in range to get that Leech Seed off. The movement speed from Ryze is just too fast when he also triggers off the drum charge. But now with, well, lol, replicant. Short range jump there, RTZ. But they'll take the tier 1 tower. Even through the living the fortification, there's no backdoor regeneration to protect these tier 1 towers. So it's just a simple tank, take, move. RTZ gets even more. 3 for 0 now. Nothing was actually on that courier when it died, and it did die smack bang in the middle of the Ancients of the Dire side. So for some reason it found itself in the middle of the fight. Zaya was the only casualty of war for EG during that last engagement too, as he sits 2 for 4. With no Lich ulti cast. Never got the sucker off. For now, crit, still with no blink dagger, still with no magic wand. But still with no blink dagger or any sort of maneuverability, which is what's required for him. Without it, you're not going to have much joy with that Rubik. Like, picking up from range and throwing in some aggressive iron shells, that's nice, but it just actually helps out Lich because it allows him to farm underneath his own tier 2 tower. Took a little bit of damage, but that was negligible. Bottom lane, Prophet's going to TP in here. Are they going to try and finally force EG's tier 1 tower? It's already healing up with the living armor. And now is in fact protected by it. Drums Antro's been purchased off a Bloodseeker. He's going to be ready to fight this one. There's a Birmingham engagement possibly on top too. Zai way too long. Picked up, thrown down. Relocates on the way here. Zai won't get the ulti off in time. But they did see where the relocate went from. It was right underneath the T1 tower. So they got themselves a kill here. The creep wave is still available, but Tree's going to have ulti. And Wisp, well, he's coming back by himself. Except it's the fact he's going to die. EG will be happy to mop him up. But they lose their tier 2 tower on the top lane for it. This is the trick. They should lose their They will lose their tier two tower on the top lane for it.
Top tower has fallen.
Fortification living armor's not that strong. And Lynch, I don't think he didn't have frost armor on the building. And even that's only level one. But EG's gonna try and find their trade-off. And that's forcing bottom lane. Arteezy went straight in for the BKB. With the Diakoria respawn up, is it gonna pick up anything important for anybody? Or looks like it's all gonna pass unnoticed. Especially considering Darkseer is the only one with extra gold on himself. MYM's gonna come in. They're defending this one. The trees to the front lines to try and hold him out. Sprouts on Universe. If he wants to, he could back himself out of this. And what a crit still. He just stole Iron Shell again. Really great counter push ability against him. Now it works for him. Didn't work on the top lane. I think there's a loud side of fire underneath his tower. And MYM weren't looking to dive then. But when you're trying to stop a three-man push on the bottom lane, Iron Shell is perfect. Especially when Bloodseeker is one of those guys. Shadowblade's now done on DK. Is that BKB on the slide flying out? It is. So both BKB as well as Shadowblade is now completed. And MYM looking pretty solid in their position again. And the experienced Grav is telling me something else. But so far I haven't seen EG capable of taking a team fight. Also because they haven't had one yet. They've been evading a lot of it and not looking for the openings. Now middle lane, Whisper locate with the Dragon Tongue, with the stun, living armor. Let's get this ulti off right now. Oh, did he? No, he didn't. He lit a Frost Blast. He could have let that ulti go. But everyone else wasn't there for him. On the bottom lane in the meantime though, Ace, he's TPing out, attacking once. Bloodseeker. That was the last moment he could have attacked then. The last moment he could have attacked then. But they get two for the price of one. Tree and Rubik for the Lich. And now Darkseer is able to afford up a Blink Dagger. Now all he needs is the extra man to go with it. And both Universe as well as PBD have already popped their Arcane Boots, so they're bone dry for the regeneration for now. Teezy's up to 1800 gold. That could be for Ghost Scepter. In this game, that's actually not as a lethal kind of item to turn on. Because you're not going to get Dagons. You're not going to have any of this magical burst damage coming away. You got basically, Breathe Fire, Fade Bolt, Wisp Spirits. Yeah, Wisp Spirits. And then you've got... Yeah, that's it. Dark Pact, I believe. Yeah, magical damage too. It's a little bit of it. But the most important thing is you just can't get right-click down. And I think maybe he'll go straight in for that because then he'll be able to go into the E-Blade straight away. And then he could focus on targets like Wisp and such. Maybe in this game he may consider trying to go in for either Amanda style or just the earlier Yasha. Just so he's got some stats behind him. Some movement speed, some attack damage to work with before he goes in for E-Blades. And just rely on the fact that he is already 4-0 and he can stay ahead of the farm. So he doesn't have to have something which makes sure he can stay alive during fights. So far he's had no massive problems with that. He's about to get a lot more money too. That tier 1 tower, his days are numbered. The first damage is about to be dealt to it, unless Rubik was able to steal that living armor and regenerate it back up again. Which means maybe it's the second damage to be dealt to it. With the catapult and the creep wave. They could have waveformed it down, but I think it's the bottom lane where they're looking at more PPD. Tree ulti may as well go, and now the Lich ulti will also go over. Down to that's only twice though. Really negligible. Link has already triggered off the 10-second BKB. As they're all trying to just run themselves away. Zai jukes Link around the tree lines. Pounces up, so jukes him again. Moves on down. Universe body blocks him. Backs up. Makes the wall. Makes a copy of Link as well. Prophet has managed to kill off Mason in the meantime. So Bloodseeker on the sidelines. And they're trying to chase in deeper. Universe, he's got Blink available, but he does not want to jump in that far. Not when you got Morphling waveforming into the fight with the Breathe Fire from Ryze as well. Ace will pick himself up a double kill here. PPD, no stun from Ryze, still on cooldown. 3 euros lost, Morphling now battling up against Ace, able to get at least a bit of a revenge kill on this top. leaves one replicate behind. He needs a little bit more mana before he can TP back to base and regenerate. And then he can come back up to the top lane and finish the tower. But MYM, another great fight for them. They take out EG on the bottom lane, and now they can force into the tier 2 tower as well.
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
Lindley's just got to sit back and regenerate first. They give him an urn charge, attempt to the front line. Taking the tower is more important. PPD's already gone into Nature's Guise. Moving down, remember that's going to be indicated to Link too. But they just run themselves away. Rest of the TP's work. And for all the support that EG brought to that bottom lane, they will find no kills. EG's only got one real choice right now, and that's all two real choices. It's teamfight pickoff, which means smoke, or they go for Roshan. That's the two choices. With the sentry wall being planted, this looks like a Roshan. Their issue is, though, have they got another sentry? Sly can slip in there. They have no... Yeah, okay, now we can't. The observer ward outside. Now we can't slip in there. It's like I said, no vision outside the pit. So their sentry ward actually did nothing for them. But they're able to take Roshan very, very quickly. So Bloodseeker now has himself an Aegis the Immortal. Trying to just cover up Mason a little bit more until he can finally finish up that Heaven's Halberd. And now they're going to force the mid. Surge on the Bloodseeker. Trying to get him in range to get an ulti off. Always crit the initial one they wanted. If they knew Ryze was up and he ran up north, they could have found themselves an easy kill. Waveform up to the higher ground and go nuts from there. Arteezy's doing the best job he can to force this lane in as fast as possible. Bloodseeker again on the hunt. Difficult to do now as we're about to head into nighttime, so the vision's about to get very, very restricted. Oh, sorry, daytime, as the vision's about to stop being very, very restricted. we turned that one around. Adaptive strike stolen. Okay, we just bounce back and forth. Bloodseeker stunned up for the moment. Tree, he's got the ulti. There's the back in with the Tillikins are stunned. Now the tree ulti will go off. Link locked inside, pounce back out again. The Lich ulti is now starting to go to work too. Bouncing around inside the creep, staying with the heroes too. Universe. Well, EG, they're just not surviving through this. Link has just got so much they are building. This Wisp working overtime with that mech as well. EG, that is now the third fight in a row which has not gone their way. Arteezy stun? Lol. He was slightly up the hill. PBD will also TP himself out to safety. Underneath the Observer Ward, but MYM will make a beeline for the mid. Tier 2 towers will be brought down. They have a 34 second window. Bloodseeker does have buyback, but even just forcing that is worth it at this point. As we get BKB being built up by Bloodseeker, Heaven's Howl, but he's given up on it. It's a lot of strength on that Bloodseeker, but he doesn't have the ability to freely move during these engagements. And that's where the major problem's been coming in for him.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
It's been MYM setting the terms. So tier 2 tower also lost from EG after that engagement. I'm pretty sure a sizable advantage has been gained. Yep. Push it up, just over 4,000 gold earned. Experience, which was a rather large victory there for EG, is also switching around. EG, they need to be able to get the range of this game back under control. Because if they don't, I got DK, he's about to hit Frost Dragon form too. They're about to have AoE slow damage coming out. EG's teamfight combo is negligible. This damn Lich has four braces to his damn... Yeah, what? What is this? Like, seriously. This is their only way they can do it. Looks like Arteezy as well as Link just had themselves a little bit of a shared moment. Ryze with 3.7k. Is this just going to be a straight BKB for him? It may be a straight death for him. They need more. They're already backing up a little bit further. Link and Wisp. It's just so easy to bring in that combination. It's quick, very, very quick. It's a straight up relocate and go for the kill. Link's also getting very close to finishing up his Skadi. So more life points. Easier chasing. Yeah. Actually, oh no. He's switching it on me. It's a Lincoln's fear for Link. He He might have realized that BKB doesn't help him if Bloodseek is able to get the ulti up beforehand. Because it's all HP removal. So it doesn't work for magic. Like, the magic immunity doesn't block it, but obviously that's not magical damage. Oh, that's easy. Easy pickings for farm in the mid. Now with 2.7k gold, the full mana style completed. Bottom lane too, Ryze had a very, very long way here. I think he realizes it as well. Now, TP's back up. Our profit. That's one way to put down aggressive observer wards. Way to keep yourself stranded for 20 seconds as well, unless he uses his TP to crawl. But he doesn't want to put that thing on cooldown yet. He wants to try and find some kills for this. He put the aggressive observer ward down. So if they see EG going back to their own lanes to farm, then they can do something about it. That's the primary goal right now. They know where EG move. They know if they smoke up. Then, of course, in order to do that, they also need to have aggressive wards around this region. And maybe even a little bit further down into here. Obviously, that's a lot of warding to do. And with the limit on wards, you can't do it all the time. Looks like Crit was just able to steal four levels up in vacuum. This Wisp is also well on his way to having the BKB. With Mech, Ogre Club, and Urn, his strength is already looking pretty damn good for this Wisp. How did Rubick go too? Did he ever actually steal it? No, yeah. He hasn't managed to steal Morph ability yet. We don't have ourselves at a full strength Rubick. Looks like Arteezy being very, very good with changing himself, aka not doing it right in front of all of MYM, especially Crit. Because that does actually rely on Crit to survive through the engagements to get it. Or at least through the initial start. Oh, there's your Scythe of Vice up for Nature's Prophet. So we add a Hex towards the mix now for MYM. That's going to be a nice little way to control up that Bloodseeker, who still doesn't have his BKB. Mason needs more time. There's a Mithril Hammer on the Courier for him. 200 gold, 300 gold, but with Arteezy being ganked up on the top lane, Hex goes to work instantly. He's still got a replica to jump to, which now he does do so. Down the tree line. Ganking up a Morphling is always difficult enough. When he's got a replica up, it's next to impossible. But now they're going to try and force bottom lane. PPD's in here, Bloodseeker as well. His full BKB is completed. So with TP's in, EG will probably have a better fight this time around. Just because the BKB is available. Downside is they're still going to get through that Lincoln Sphere, which is over on the Slark. And Slark, Dark Pact, tries to jump in. There's Ace already, hexing over on the Bloodseeker. Is he going to trigger the BKB? Yep, the VAC will come as well. It's a return VAC from Universe into the wall, and then the Lich only to go down into Link, and he'll have to take the damage up. Able to break free of this Entangle, the tree ulti. Oh, he may as well even have that sucker. But Bloodseeker wrapping this up with the Urn Charges. They keep his life low. They trigger the Lincoln Sphere again. Ace is able to TP himself away, but Link's life is now forfeit. They got two heroes moving down the river as well. They're just fake Morphlings, none of them are real. But EG, they show the BKB for the first time from the Bloodseeker. Quite successful, but also MYM showing the fact that they don't really care about a lot of these control abilities from EG. So, Shiva's Guard. Up and available. Almost, for this Darkseer. These team fights are going to start to get a lot messier for MYM. Like, that Lich ulti is now at least level 2. As he goes into Necro Books, as opposed to, like, trying to buff up that ulti with the Aghanim Scepter. Because he realizes, like, he needs the Necros up against a hero like a Slark, just to burn off the mana. Because they've got nothing else to do such a thing. Whispering locate, and goodbye Arteezy. No replicate this time around. And the Lich ulti, which looks to be stolen. Arteezy BKB. Strength morphing up. Oh, waveform's down. Zai is also here. And then Dragon Tail stun from Ryze. Perfect maneuver in. Arteezy, that living armor. Look at him just move up in the life points. They actually just cannot kill him. And in the meantime, the bottom tower goes out in favor of EG. And that is a lot of strength morph to have available. And with it, a full gank from MYM will fail again. Something they really needed to get to. They needed that straight up burst damage before he had the life points. But they didn't catch him low enough. And now Arteezy with 4.7k gold on himself. Over on the courier, that's actually a Yasha for Mason. So he's not going to go into the Heaven's Halberd. Instead, we're going S and Y build. Coming in for the Bloodseeker. Which maybe means he wants to rush up into something else. I would say normally a Basher into something more controlling like that. But in this game, it may be worth going in for a Mjolnir. Because he's already attacking like a beast during the fights. And this way, at least, they've got some kind of pushing power up against that tree and protector beyond that of an Iron Shell and a Morphling Waveform. Bottom lane, there's movement coming in. Shiva's Guard from Universe, vacking in the Wisp. And now tree, lead seed, Wisp is trying to relocate out.
Radiant structures are fortified.
So, Lich goes down the middle lane. Wisp would be coming back in here. Link, he's got a choice to fight or not. With the Jammia, he's going to try and pounce in. And now they'll see if they can fight or not. Bloodseeker pops off the BKB. He's already blood raged up, so he's looking for the extra DPS in this fight. Beating in on that Nature's Prophet. Hitting hard. The Darkseer wall has gone down now. And they just keep walking through it. Lich ulti, which came out from the Rubick, and all of EG, they have to split themselves up. Universe! He goes down and bounces back. The Darkseer wall works against EG. The fight was looking good up until that point for EG. And then Rubick came in and turned the tides. No way to get out. Blood Rage was even solid, so a silence to add to that mix-up. And Link, searching for Arteezy, but Arteezy able to just TP himself out. And he's got a full Skadi now. And that Rubick Lich ulti couldn't have come at a better time. And the fact that Darkseer wall was there, he kept having copies. He kept fighting copy after copy. So it just kept bouncing around. All he had to do was make sure there was enough. And the hits would just keep hitting. Ryze, why did you deny Invis Rune? Safety first. Arteezy now going in for a solo Roshan. With Living Armor, he can obviously do this too. Their strength moves up a little bit. Frost Armor, the whole shebang. Very, very simple job. Not the fastest Roshan you'll ever see in your life. But at the same time, getting the Aegis Immortal, well worth it for what they lose is some time in their lanes, that's it. Let's get a burst farm after this. And there's the Aegis over on Arteezy. And Morphling is pretty damn fat. Sitting at almost 18,000 net worth. The next three though belong to MYM. Then you hit the Bloodseeker and the Darkseer. But then again, Bloodseeker and Darkseer already give everything they want to. And they're going to try and force what? Mid? Morphling setting up towards the top lane to try and do the counter push. It's a couple of trees there. And Bloodseeker's also running down towards the mid. But it's easy to just force out the top a little bit further so they can get some breathing space. And then he'll jump to his Replicate. He's got a long time to do it anyway. So there's no massive problem for him. He might even be able to have enough time to force out another creep wave. But that Replicant Lich just sitting inside the tree line. With Blinks a ways. Wisp as well as Link are still up on this top lane. But this Lich ulti. Oh, this Lich illusion. He's going to lose it now. He's actually going to move. He's going to go into it. He's like, oh no. Lich is stuck. What's he supposed to do? But there's a real one there in Arteezy. He does join the fight. He's pushed out the top enough. Bottom lane though, of course, you can never win on a proper split push battle up against a level 3 Necro book. Nature's Prophet with 4 points up in those trees. So the only thing they can do is push faster, and they're doing so. Their tier 2 tower evaporates. There's no fortification for MYM either. They must come back and fight. They can't go for a trade here. A tier 2 for a tier 3. A tier 2 and a tier 3 for MYM's favor. For a tier 3 and a Rax. DK, now the sun's gonna go. Bloodseeker losing a lot of life. Arteezy, where's your combination to come in with this back wall? It's not even there yet. The Lich Hold is flying around. Down to crit, back up again. Now they get their back combo wall. Outside the main base, Arise trying to get back. A triple buyback from MYM. They're holding on with everything they've got, but it's a triple kill for Arteezy. He even turned the DK against MYM. They can rotate middle or they can push for the GG call now. There's gems on the deck to be picked up and they're gonna rotate bottom, sorry, not middle. My brain's still working right. But there goes your tier 3 tower in the bottom lane. Into the range ranks, melee ranks, and there it is, GG. MYM will be eliminated from the D2CL, and Evil Geniuses will advance themselves through into the playoffs of the D2CL, which means Relax can relax. They will advance through. Virtus Pro find themselves being knocked out with MYM out of the group stages here. And that also means, well, we have ourselves, not all of our positions out for the D2CL. We're short of just a couple of them here. But as far as Group 2 goes now, that is locked in position. Alliance will take number 1 position with their 13 points, while EG will manage to come through with 11 points in total. And then we look over towards Rox gets in 3rd position with 8 points, with Mecha Makers finishing with just 1 point, having 4 losses as well as 1 draw to their name. And as far as Group 1 goes, Team Empire is the only team secured a position so far in Group 1. Actually, technically, they all 4 of them are, so you will have Fnatic, Power Rangers, Na'Vi, and Team Empire all go through. The only question will be exact positioning. If Fnatic end up going through with a draw up against Dream Team, we have ourselves a tie up to 2nd position, which does, of course, affect the positions going into the playoff bracket. But either way, we'll have that sorted out over on the 15th. That's when the D2CL stream does return. For now, though, guys, head yourself over to the European hub for the International 4. The matches are going on. I'm going to head myself over to our social live stream and maybe jump downstairs. Make sure you do check out the TI4 EU hub primary stream. This stream is actually streaming out the matches as well as our social stream, which is jumping between all 4. So if you want to check that out, definitely go ahead and do so. Join.com up on the top right. You got everything that's there. The live and upcoming tool tells you what stream is also streaming what, so you can follow all the information there. Thanks for watching, everyone. VODs available, dailymotion.com/joindota, as well as in 2 days time, youtube.com/joindota. And I'll see you all over on our EU Hub live streams.
Let's get cracking!
This is fucking awesome.
But shit, it was 99 cents. I get capping it, watching it. About to go and get some compliments. Passing up on those moccasins. Someone else has been walking in. Bummy and grudgy fucking it. I am stunting and flossing and saving my money. And I'm hella happy that's a bargain, bitch. I'ma take your grandpa style. I'ma